Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The portfolio on this occasion is education and skills. The usual reminder, anybody wishing to ask a supplementary question should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. And I call first number one, Stephanie Callaghan.
To ask the Scottish Government what measures it is taking to encourage the uptake of education maintenance allowance amongst eligible pupils.
Cabinet Secretary General Gorruth.
The education maintenance allowance is vital in supporting young people from lower income households to overcome financial barriers and to stay in education. It is a central component of this Government's support for young people from economically disadvantaged backgrounds. The specific promotion and awareness raising of the programme locally remains the responsibility of our delivery partners, local authorities, the Scottish Council, Funding Council rather, and learning centres such as colleges and schools as set out in the annual guidance. However, the Government continues to work closely with those delivery partners to ensure effective promotion is maintained, and I would encourage every young person who is eligible to apply and receive this vital support.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. School attendance can be a huge challenge for pupils with additional support needs, and flexibility is key, with many young people requiring reduced timetables to best meet their educational needs. And I'm hearing recently that some of these pupils are told they're not eligible for education maintenance allowance, and this seems unfair where a part-time timetable is a reasonable adjustment to meet an identified support need. So can I ask what steps are the Scottish Government taking to ensure additional support need pupils are encouraged to remain in education without compromising access to critical financial support, and whether accurate data on part-time timetables is routinely available?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Stephanie Callaghan for raising this really important issue, and I very much share her concern if young people with additional support needs find themselves in that position. I think even more concerning given the reported increase in relation to additional support needs pupils towards the end of last year nationally. Our EMA guidance does make clear the need for flexibility when administering the EMAs for young people with additional support needs, because we recognise they very much often find themselves requiring non-standard attendance patterns that might fall short of the full-time criteria. We know that institutions are also encouraged to be flexible when they're agreeing on attendance patterns for ASM pupils, and that should be agreed and written into the pupils' learning agreement. But we will continue to reiterate to delivery partners the need for this flexibility. And in the meantime, if the member has any particular cases where pupils with additional support needs have found themselves ineligible, then I'm very happy that she write to me with details on those matters.
Question two, Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it has evaluated the extent to which swimming lessons are a part of the school curriculum for primary school aged pupils.
Cabinet Secretary.
Schools in Scotland have the flexibility to decide upon the content of their own physical education lessons, and so the Scottish Government does not specifically evaluate the extent to which swimming lessons form a part of those decisions. But we know that some local authorities do offer swimming lessons as part of their physical education, and in other cases, schools may take account of a range of factors, including travel time required to a swimming pool, in deciding against offering swimming lessons as part of PE. But the Government has, however, been working with the Scottish Swimming Organisation, Education Scotland, and with other stakeholders to develop interventions and approaches to give opportunities for children to become confident, safer and competent swimmers.
Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that response. Learning how to swim is a life skill that has numerous physical, social and mental health benefits. And I know others fully believe that every child should leave primary school having had the opportunity to learn to swim. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that teaching our young people how to swim is an important skill that must be easily accessible to all across Scotland? And can she advise if the Government have had any thoughts on how swimming lessons can be more embedded into the primary school curriculum?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. I think he raises an extremely important point, Presiding Officer, and I agree with Mr McGregor that learning to swim gives many physical and mental wellbeing benefits additionally, and we should be mindful of that in terms of curriculum for excellent entitlements. That's why, following the publication of the evaluation of the 22-23 pilots, the Government and Education Scotland are going to work with Scottish Swimming and Sports Scotland to look at the best approach for maximising the uptake of swimming among children and young people of school age, and I'm happy to ensure that the member is kept up to date on that work. Would welcome any further input that he may wish to provide on this matter.
A couple of supplementaries. First, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Access to things like swimming, sport, culture, languages and arts is essential for young people to enjoy learning and be fit for the future. But some are worried there's a lack of opportunity in these areas. I asked the government about young people's participation in cultural activities. It said it tracks sporting but not cultural activity. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, is she confident all young people have equal opportunity to experience these things? And will she commit to gathering data to ensure that they are?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. I think she raises an important point. And of course, as she will know, we are looking at what more we can do through the education reform agenda to ensure those entitlements are met. Now, Curriculum for Excellence provides a curriculum nationally, which is not prescriptive. One of the reasons why I cannot dictate, for example, to local authorities that they must deliver swimming lessons in the context of the member's previous questions. But in relation to cultural activity, I will speak to officials on this specific point to ensure we are meeting those entitlements. That was one of the key recommendations to come from the Hayward Review. And I'm very keen that we look again at those entitlements nationally to ensure that equality of access to our curriculum.
And Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In island communities like Shetland, the dangers of water are well understood. When I was a young child, I fell into Lerwick Harbour and almost drowned. And with that in mind, does the Scottish Government think it's acceptable that 11-year-olds are leaving primary school without the life skill of being able to swim?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question and for sharing some of her personal experience of that. And I recognise, particularly in island communities, the importance of having the skill to be able to swim. Of course, as I intimated in my response to Ms Duncan Glancy, I cannot mandate local authorities deliver swimming education, but through the work with Education Scotland, more broadly, I'm keen that we look at those entitlements. And I think the member's point is hugely important. So I would be keen to work with her and with others that might have an interest in this subject to see what more we might be able to do to support schools. We also need to recognise that not all schools will be an island community. So we need to be mindful of the local context and the availability and the accessibility of swimming pools, for example, are important in that regard. When I was at school many years ago, we had a swimming pool in the school. That's not always the case in many schools in Scotland. So we need to be mindful of availability of swimming pool access to ensure that equitability point that Ms Duncan Glancy made is met.
Question number three, Alec Rowley.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government how it's working with universities and colleges to address the reported skills gap across the economy.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, as I confirmed to Parliament last month, as per the recommendation of the Withers report, the Scottish Government will take on skills planning at the national level and support the development of skills planning at the more regional level, in so doing recognising that we must better align the education and skills system offering with the strategic skills of the needs of the economy in mind. We're developing these approaches in close collaboration with colleges and universities, along with others, specifically employers.
Alec Rowley.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Over the last year, I've met with many employers, and the key issue that they consistently raise is the lack of availability of skilled labour. What is the Government doing to encourage and support more development of skills, of training and apprenticeships? And given the cuts to the Scottish Funding Council's budget, will this result in less college places?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, it's important, and I know Alec Rowley knows this, to differentiate between skills and labour shortages and to determine, that's what we're doing, the specifics around the skills ask. That's why I've asked portfolio ministerial colleagues to carry out an exercise to identify the exact nature of current and likely future skills needs, in so doing engaging directly with colleges and universities to determine what resource and capacity currently exists to meet such asks and how we can bring all of this together. And certainly from my direct conversations with the HE and FE sectors, there's a strong appetite to develop that better alignment, which is of course in everyone's interest. On the apprenticeship point in particular, the assurance I could offer Alec Rowley is again that it's our intention to seek to better align that with the economic needs of the country.
Number of supplementaries, I'll try to get them all in. First, Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And following up on that point, ensuring there is alignment between the needs of employers and skills provision in our colleges and universities is essential, of course, to tackling skills shortages across the economy. So in that light, can I ask what work the Government is doing on a sectoral basis with employers to ensure that skills requirements now and in the future are identified and to ensure that funding of colleges and university provision is aligned to support employers' needs?
Minister.
Businesses and employers will have a crucial role to play in helping shape the provision within the system. The government's already engaging with a wide variety of employers, looking at the practicalities and options for delivering a more aligned offering. And of course, we have the skills planning team at SDS at the forefront of that work. But Ivan McKee's right to highlight the need to approach this on a sectoral basis, and it's already clear to me from my own direct engagement with employers that some sectors are more progressed than others when it comes to having the detail and the specifics that we require to move forward. And it may be that we pilot approaches as much on a sectoral level as a geographical one. All this will be looked at in detail at an employers' round table that we're putting together in the coming months. And of course, learning providers will also be in the room, because we need all sides directly involved if we're to have to deliver an agile, aligned and responsive skills and learning system.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. According to research by the Fraser of Allender Institute, Scotland's colleges boosted the Scottish economy by over £8 billion, so more than tenfold return on investment. So what impact will last year's £26 million cut and the proposed £58.7 million cut to the net college resource proposed in the government's draft budget have on that £8 billion contribution?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I think the £26 million that Liam Kerr refers to is a transition fund, so it will have no direct impact. The £58 million that he refers to was, of course, in line with the monies that were reduced in the year. So the monies that the colleges had, in reality, or have in this current year, will match almost entirely with the substance of their budget next year. But, of course, in an ideal world, we would like to be able to better fund our colleges. And if Mr Kerr has any constructive ideas as we go through the budget process, we're all ears.
And Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With the school gaps, with regards to the school gap that's currently being faced, can I ask the Scottish Government how it is working with universities and colleges to promote the uptake of modern languages?
And Minister.
Obviously, the government's clear that access to learning modern languages is vital at all stages of education to equip children and young people with the skills they need in an increasingly globalised world. Universities, however, are autonomous institutions and as such are responsible for their own course provision, and it's for them to decide how to distribute the allocation of funded places between faculties and courses. Similarly, operational decisions, including resourcing and course provision, are matters for individual colleges. But in both instances, we would look for this to be done in line with the needs of learners and the local economy.
Thank you. Question 4 and question 5 are not lodged. Question 6, Ben McPherson.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to tackle violence in schools and the impact this is having on both pupils and staff.
Cabinet Secretary.
No teacher, member of staff or pupil should have to suffer abuse in our schools. The series of summits that I held with a wide range of stakeholders on behaviour in schools concluded in November. The Behaviour in Scottish Schools research was also published, and that provides the accurate national picture in relation to behaviour in Scotland's schools. In my statement to Parliament on the 29th of November, I confirmed that a multi-year plan is in development to tackle instances of challenging behaviour, working with local authorities, trade unions and others. This plan will be published as soon as possible.
Ben McPherson.
I welcome that update and the different points that the Cabinet Secretary talked about in terms of the progress. And I fully agree that no one in our schools should feel unsafe or suffer abuse of any kind. And I'm pleased that the final stage of the series of behaviour stakeholder summits has taken place. Moving forward, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what particular attention is being given to tackling gender-based violence in our schools, which is, again, affecting both pupils and staff? And what engagement has there been with expert organisations such as Zero Tolerance, White Ribbon and She Scotland in my constituency?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. I'm very concerned by the findings in the BISR research regarding increased misogyny in our schools, which, as has been pointed out, was found to affect both pupils and staff. In the coming weeks, we will publish a national gender-based violence framework for schools that will support them in preventing and responding to gender-based violence. We will also continue to work very closely with some of our key stakeholders that the member alluded to on the gender-based violence in schools working group, which we jointly chair with Zero Tolerance and also with Rape Crisis Scotland. That's really to ensure the framework supports schools in tackling gender-based violence and sexual harassment, but also that it supports everyone in our schools to be protected, cared for, and have their rights and needs respected.
Thank you. I've got a number of supplementaries on this. We've got a little time in hand over the afternoon, so I'll take them all, but that's not an invitation to go on overly long. Brevity again. First of all, Ros McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I've been inundated with correspondence from constituents raising concerns about the widespread violence in Fife schools. In Fife, 71% of teachers who responded to a recent EIS survey reported experiencing violence on a daily basis, while officials said members have been hospitalised due to physical attacks. It's also concerning now to see that we have teenagers in Dunfermline engaging in attacks outside the school grounds. This kind of violence, including gender-based, has to stop. Now, I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary accepts that any time delay on this matter is allowing violence to escalate and embed. So when will the government's plans be implemented to support our teachers and parents?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. I think she raises a number of important points. She's commented on some specific cases I'm not cited on. If she wants to share any further detail with me, I'd be keen to see that. We are going to use the national research that has been published through the BISA research to help inform our decision-making around about this national action plan. But I think we need to be cognisant too that we need to trust our teachers in our classrooms in delivering the type of learning and teaching and the behaviour that we expect in our schools. I visited a school, two schools actually, in Glasgow yesterday, who were working to really embed strong relationships to support better behaviour across the board. So we're working at pace with the Scottish Advisory Group on Relationships and Behaviour in Schools, and also with those wider partners I mentioned in my response to Mr McPherson on the plan itself. I also met with the teaching unions in December following the update to Parliament to discuss our response. We expect to publish the plan early this year. I'm more than happy to write to the member with more detailed specifics on that. She will understand I require as Cabinet Secretary to have the buy-in and also the co-production of COSLA in that regard, given that they, of course, run our schools. But I recognise the urgency around this issue, as she has intimated in her question today.
And Willie Rennie.
In just the last few weeks, I've met a pupil support assistant with a broken wrist, and I've met a teacher who's off on long-term sick because of stress, as a result, both as a result of violence in the classroom. Now, the Education Secretary knows there's some disappointment and a degree of anger that the message from the statement in December was that teachers needed better training. And that can't be the answer. They need more in-class support, more specialist support, but can I urge the Education Secretary to look again at the issue of boundaries and consequences? Because I think we've got that out of kilter. And would she look at that again to make sure we get this right?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. He made similar suggestions in a debate, I think, at the end of term. And I, at that time, tried to intervene on him. He did not allow me to do so, if he will recall. But that was not the message from my statement to Parliament at the end of term. My statement to Parliament very much recognises the challenges here. But we also need to be cognisant as a Parliament, as a government, that the government does not run our schools directly. We trust our local authorities, such as Fife Council and the members' constituency, to support their school staff on the ground. Now, I think government has a responsibility here, which is why I have brought forward the national plan, but that has to be done in conjunction with local authorities. He's given a number of examples there, and he's talked again, I think, about consequences. And I've been very clear that that national action plan will look to set out some of that in more detail. Actually, some of the feedback from the BISA events from head teachers directly has been a call for more of that to be set out at national level. I'm keen that we give that clarity so that head teachers understand they have these options at their disposal. But I do say to the member that we need to be careful not to patronise the profession, who very much recognise how to develop and deliver good quality learning and teaching and to set boundaries for our young people. But in that process, they also need support from their local authorities. That's why local authorities and COSLA have to be key to development of this national action plan and to the Zagreb's work that I responded to the previous member in relation to our action.
Okay, to get in the next supplementaries, I'm going to need a bit more brevity in both the questions and the responses. First, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you for your indulgence, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will know that non-contact time is crucial to addressing the conditions in schools. Does the Cabinet Secretary have the report that she commissioned on delivering that? And if she does, when will she be able to share some of the detail with Parliament?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. I very much agree with her on this issue. I do not yet have that report from my officials, but I'm happy to write to the member as soon as I have received it, because I recognise the ask here around about that additionality in terms of class contact time.
That's an example to follow. Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it could offer to Northfield Academy within my Aberdeen Donside constituency, where Education Scotland inspectors recently stated more needs to be done to make pupils feel safe.
Cabinet Secretary.
As the member will know, I visited Northfield Academy back in August to understand the action they were taking in relation to some of the concerns at that school. They undeniably remain a number of challenges, but I am advised that the leadership team at the school is committed to driving improvements for pupils and staff alike. And while, of course, it is a matter for local authorities and schools to decide on specific support that might be needed, as part of our commitment to ensure schools are safe and consistent environments for all, we are working on that national action plan that I've mentioned in previous responses today, Presiding Officer. On the specific issue of Northfield Academy, I have requested an update from my officials, from the Interim Chief Inspector, in terms of any additional support that we may be able to provide the school and the local authority at this time.
And Alec Rowley, thank you. Given the extent of the problem, would the Cabinet Secretary think it would be worthwhile encouraging schools to get this debate going at a local level involving parents, pupils, teachers, all staff in the schools, to actually try and come up and resolve the issue at a local level and certainly engage people in the problem?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member makes a really interesting and positive suggestion, and yes, I do. There have been a number of different pieces of research published over the last few months in relation to behaviour in Scotland schools, but at the turn of the year, there was research published around about attendance and disintegration between home and school over the pandemic. I think that's part of the challenge here. I say to the member, his suggestion around about a local approach to how we re-engage the family with the school would be a really worthwhile thing to pursue, and I'd be more than happy to work with the member on that issue.
And question 7, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to address any challenges in relation to the accessibility of traditional skills programmes to ensure that young people have access to career opportunities.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, Historic Environment Scotland continues to champion traditional skills and is working with stakeholders across the country to address traditional skills gaps to help ensure our historic buildings can thrive as part of the country's sustainable future. Additionally, Skills Development Scotland delivers careers information, advice and guidance in all state secondary schools, dedicated centres and community locations nationwide. Its all-age service empowers people from all communities to make their own learning and career decisions based on the best available career intelligence.
Miles Briggs.
Thank the Minister for that answer. The closure of Edinburgh College's stonemasonry programme has raised serious concerns about the future of stonemasonry here in the capital and across Scotland. A recent stonemasonry survey report found that over 200,000 of all buildings in Scotland are pre-1919 and stated that we will need a healthy supply of stonemasons to adapt these and make sure they're fit for purpose in decades to come. Can I ask the Minister, what work is the Scottish Government doing to provide for future generations of stonemasons, and what work is being undertaken to develop new models to deliver national courses and apprenticeship schemes?
Minister.
Officer, can I associate myself with the importance that Miles Briggs places on this matter? As he does, I recognise the need to ensure that stonemasonry, like other traditional skills, are prioritised within our apprenticeship and training offering. The Minister for Culture, Europe and Environment and I have tasked Historic Environment Scotland with developing proposals for a sustainable future model which ensures we continue to be able to access the skills required to maintain our historic buildings. But it has to be recognised that delivery of stonemasonry apprenticeships is costly, and the numbers involved do not produce sufficient critical mass to allow for course provision to be delivered across a multitude of locations. So without wishing to prejudge matters, it may be that a centre or centres of excellence model might be the best way forward. And we do currently have three colleges, City of Glasgow, UHI, Elgin and Forth Valley, engaged in such delivery. But I hope I provided Miles Briggs with some reassurance, and given his long-standing and genuine interest in the topic, I'd be happy to continue to engage with him on that.
Good question. 8, Pam Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to ensure that teachers are fully equipped to safeguard the wellbeing of pupils.
Cabinet Secretary.
The wellbeing and safety of children and young people in Scotland is a key priority for the Government. Our National Guidance for Child Protection in Scotland describes the responsibilities and expectations for everyone who works with children and young people and emphasises the key role that the education workforce have in support and protection for children. Education Scotland's Safeguarding and Education National Network brings together leads at local authority level to share safeguarding and education practice. The professional standards for Scotland's teachers also set out the role of teachers in ensuring the wellbeing and safety of children and young people.
Pam Gosell.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Last month, the UK Government published comprehensive guidance for teachers on how to support pupils questioning their gender in schools. The guidance acknowledges the critical role that biological sex plays in maintaining safety and promoting equality in schools, while also recognising the profound psychological effects that the social transitions have on young people, and the need for parental involvement in these life-changing decisions. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, does she agree that the teachers should be fully equipped to discuss these issues with the pupils? And will the Government introduce the same guidance for Scottish schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank the Member for her question. As she may be aware, of course, we are reviewing currently our relationship, sexual health and parenthood guidance. So the consultation closed back at the end of November last year. We received over 4,000 responses to the consultation. And my officials are currently analysing responses, and a report on that consultation will be produced shortly. The initial findings suggest that the guidance currently needs to give more clarity, and the guidance will be updated in light of those and that feedback and other findings of the consultation in due course. I'd be more than happy to write to the member with an update as soon as we publish that consultation data.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.